Hello, everybody, and welcome to the September 21st, 2001 Culture Advisory Committee meeting. I'd like to welcome everybody and call the session to order. A reminder of those, if you do have video, it would be nice to have your video on the screen, but if not, I understand. But please keep your microphones on mute until we open up questions or raise your hand or see the chat box and let me know if you have a question. So we do have a delegate today. So the first thing I also have to do is disclosure of interest. Does anybody have any disclosure of interest on the agenda items that were sent out last week or the update from Monday? Okay, I'll take that as a no. So we have approval of the agenda and previous minutes next on the docket. So approval of the agenda, I just wanted to note a change that item number 5, Katrina Pike, is unable to meet with us today, but Laura Gibbs is here to take on her role in that area. And I think we had the additional updates sent out on Monday for the extra items on the deconcession list and updates. And then I believe the previous minutes were sent out. So I'm looking for a committee member, or we have consensus of the committee to approve the agenda and adopt the minutes as received. Looking for our appointed members.
Hi, Ariana here. I can move to that.
Thank you. Okay. So we're going to go to our first delegation, which is from Tammy Lynn Gravel. And I believe she's on the phone and she has a presentation for us today. Tammy?
Hi there, everybody. How are you tonight?
Very
Everybody's
good.
Doing good. I'm glad you can hear me. I'm just going to switch my speakerphone, my speaker up. Just want to make sure you can still hear me. All is well?
Everything's perfect.
Okay, beautiful. Well, thank you for allowing me to speak with you guys tonight. I am also a member of the Pickering Accessibility Advisory Committee, and it was under their advisement that I approached Jesse about talking about a project that we have been working on. In 2019, the Pickering Football Club was awarded a Ontario Trillium Fund grant, allowing us to study barriers to sport and recreational opportunities. And we're particularly targeting priority populations and trying to get input from newcomers, seniors, people with disabilities, the LGBTQ community, and Indigenous populations, and a number of other cultural groups. To find out what their experiences have been in accessing sport and recreational opportunities here within the Durham area. So we're not just focusing on Pickering, obviously. We are extending ourselves beyond the reach of Pickering. But this is a great opportunity for us to learn, and we've had some amazing feedback from our area municipalities who are going to assist us in getting out into their communities. How we are moving forward is, let me give you a little bit more background before I just jump into everything. So in 2019, we were awarded this grant, and we did some amazing legwork within that first 5 months. And then, of course, COVID hit. So we had to shut everything down because a big portion of what we are doing relies on community consultation. And because of COVID, obviously, there were a number of challenges. And so we put our project on hold and now have just restarted it as of September. We have until December to finalize our report to the government. I think we might get we've edged in a little bit of an extension to January. But over the next couple of months, we have three different, I'll say, projects that we're working on. So we're going to be releasing a barriers to sport and recreation survey, and we're going to be releasing those out into the community across Durham. We're going to be organizing WebEx and in-person focus groups and interviews. So we're trying to connect with our local community to find leaders who can help us reach the communities that we are trying to target. And then the other thing that we're going to be doing and I'm actually really excited about this, is we're going to be offering free recreational opportunities at our facility. Unfortunately, given the time when there is availability, as with, I think, all facilities, our facility is quite busy during the evening, so we are having to organize these activities during the day, which I recognize is not ideal for everybody. But we do have a very large seniors and people with disability community from our club, and we're hoping that we can extend the reach of this project through our seniors and people with disabilities who we hope will attend this free programming. So the programming is going to be on Monday mornings in the months of October and November. We're going to be offering free recreational and sport opportunities within our club. So if you guys haven't been to our facility, it's about, I guess it's just over under 10 years old. It's a fully inclusive facility. What is amazing about our facility is we have a great indoor dome space, which is ideal for indoor walking. I know that there is a large group of people that do walk at the Pickering Town Center. Our facility offers a little bit more security, where we have a turf field, so if people have any issues with their joints or balance issues, if somebody were to fall, it's a little bit of a softer landing. And the turf itself is quite soft, and there's staff around that are watching. We find it's a very social environment, so while people are doing their walking or other recreational activities, we have, we do walking soccer, we have badminton equipment, bocce equipment, we have hockey sticks, there's so much opportunity for trying out different sports, and this is going to be free. So what we're trying to do is entice people to come to the facility on Mondays, hang out with us, play some games. We're going to offer coffee and tea, and then we're trying to engage those people that come into the facility. We're trying to engage them to participate in the survey that we will have available. We have a number of different surveys that we're hoping to circulate throughout the community, specifically targeting the various communities that we're looking to get feedback from. And, just get to know some new people within the community. We ran a program, I guess it was 4 years ago, it was called In Motion out of our facility, and it was very successful. We found a lot of the participants really enjoyed getting together for the social component. They loved coming to the facility, playing some games, and then having a coffee, tea, and we had baking wars. It was really something special. So we're hoping to create that friendly environment for anybody to come into the facility, and for us to have an opportunity to talk to people and gain some insight into what their experiences have been, whether it's current experiences or experiences that they've had from an early age and growing up in their participation in sport and recreation. So that's where we're at right now. Does anybody have any questions?
Are there any questions from the committee for Tammy Lynn Gravel? And I want to remind the committee members, attached to the agenda is also a profile of what she was just speaking about in the Pickering letterhead, and along with her contact information. So I'll open up the floor to any questions from the committee.
So one other thing that go ahead, Kathy.
Just with the library, and I don't know if you wanted to put up a flyer in the library to advertise your Monday morning program.
Oh, that would be great.
And if you'd like to talk offline, if you wanted to put any surveys in the library for pickup, then maybe we can arrange for that. And I'm connected with all the Durham libraries, so.
Oh, that would be great. I really appreciate that. Okay, I will connect with you separately. That would be wonderful. Thank you so much. What I also wanted to let you guys know too is that we are actually offering honorariums to cultural groups. I know that this has been Kathy. Do I still have the floor? I'm sorry.
Yep, you're okay. Yep, go ahead.
Honorarium. Okay. I'm watching the video and Kathy's talking, so I must have a delay on the video. So I'm just going to close my computer up. So because COVID has been such a tough time, we were trying to think of creative ways to sort of invest our grant money into the community. We were looking at some marketing opportunities and thought that the best way to sort of market this research that we're doing is to give back to our community. So we've decided to, those cultural groups that are able to help us get a minimum of 15 people to participate in virtual focus groups, we are going to be offering honorariums to those organizations. So that's just it's just a way to entice more organizations to get involved.
Do we have any other questions from the committee for Tammy at this moment? Okay, well, thank you very much, Tammy, for joining us today. And I'll extend an invitation to any of the members here or watching the video later on to pass any information or questions on to myself, and I can make sure I forward them off to Tammy.
Wonderful. So, Tammy, I appreciate that. Okay, well, thank you for your time, everybody. Have a great night.
Thank you very much. Okay. So we'll move on to item number 5, which is the Pinikaring Museum Village, and Laura Gibbs will be speaking on behalf of all those subjects today. Laura, how are you this evening? You're on mute. I think you're on mute, Laura. Laura, can you hear me okay?
Yeah,
I can't hear you. I think you're on mute. Volume, maybe?
I just heard her.
You can hear me?
Yes, I can.
Now we got you.
You got me now? Okay, I hope I was on mute before because my kids are going to bed, so there's
perfect now.
Okay, so I'll start with am I able to share my screen or no?
No, I don't think so in this case. Your items were sent out, and the people should have a version of it on their inbox.
Okay, so we shared a presentation. We shared a Prezi presentation that came out. And it's about, Rumali, are you able to share your screen or no?
Yes, I can. I'm not too sure of the item though, the attachment that you would like me to show.
So it's a Prezi PowerPoint, it's a link. Do you have it? Let me see here.
If you do have it, you could also
I'll put it in the chat. See if that works.
I think I have it open. Let me try sharing my screen.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. Awesome. Okay, that's it. Can everybody see that?
Thank you, Rumali. I can see it now.
Perfect. Okay. This for me. Okay, so we wanted to get some feedback on this project proposal. We're putting in a grant application to the Museum Assistance Program on November 1st. And we've been doing a lot of work on COVID recovery because we've lost, prior to 2019, 70% of our audience was school of visitors. And so we've basically lost that audience in the last 2 years. So we're working on a recovery strategy, and this is it. So this is an amazing exhibit. And essentially what it is you can go through the next. There's like quite a lot of slides. So if we just kind of keep flipping through, Ramali, that will be fine. I'll just kind of talk as we go. So what it is, it's a trailer-based exhibit. So we'll purchase a large like hitch trailer that attaches to a truck, and we'll outfit it in a traveling exhibit all about corn. And the purpose of that would be to regrow our audiences, do school programs outside the museum, like on the school property, and then also have an opportunity to have this exhibit go out into the community for greater visibility, and just to let people know we're with the museum. So you can forge ahead. So we're going through all the. So we want to broaden programs. One of the cool things about this exhibit is it will be a STEAM-based exhibit. So that's science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. And so our traditional audience has been grade 3 students, but this would allow us to meet many different curriculum links so that we could, if we parked it at a school for a week, we could offer different programs to different students while it's parked there. So you can keep, this is about raising awareness. You can move it along there. Assist educators. So we're really concerned about people coming back to the museum for field trips. And that was most of our visitation in the past. And so this is an opportunity for us to potentially go out to schools while COVID measures are still in place, potentially next year and the year after. But knock on wood, that's not the case, but it would let us take this out in a more likely kind of field trip scenario. We can go ahead. And of course, it would be a potential revenue stream for us. So most of our school visits are on a break-even model. So the revenue we get in from the paying participants just covers like our staffing and some of our overhead. But this would be an opportunity to replace that program with this kind of model. Okay, so this is like, why corn? So corn is everywhere. There's a First Nations link that we'd be hoping to tie into and tell some of the story about how early corn was one of the first things that was farmed in Ontario. It has links to early settlers. So when they came to Canada, corn was new. And so, you know, new recipes, and they had to learn about how to use it. There's different varieties in Ontario today. We've got sweet corn, popcorn, and field corn. So we can talk about that. And then we can talk about industry and technology. So of course, now corn is used in almost anything. Plastic, ethanol, it's used in modern technology, it's used in all kinds of stuff. So we thought there'd be some really cool links to how it's evolved over time. You're doing a great job on the navigating there. So this is kind of what it would look like. So it'd be a large hitch trailer, like I mentioned, and the inside would be a very much a hands-on exhibit. So go to the next one. So the hands-on components could be virtual reality experiences. We're looking to outfit the inside with a workable kitchen for a science lab. There would be touchable models. There'd be games. So you could, you know, work against the timer. We want a hands-on model so that we can link into the soil curriculum. We can talk about seeds, all that kind of thing. And then, of course, the lab so people can make their own plastic. We can learn about fermentation. We can make our own edible paint. Do all kinds of cool experiments. Sorry, this is a video, so you can skip ahead. We don't need to learn how to we don't need to learn how to make plastic today. You get the gist. So something really fun, really fun for students or visitors to learn about some of the modern uses of corn today. And of course, we'd love to experiment with VR experiences, including driving a tractor. And we, you know, we'd love for that to be a heritage tractor, or seeing what happens inside a kernel when it heats up and gets popping. And then, of course, we would, you know, there's got to be popcorn. So we're this presentation was made for partners, but we are looking at this point for partners because the grant would require that this exhibit travel. And so we've reached out to some of our agricultural museums. We're looking at potentially having it travel to like seniors residences. And obviously the schools was something that we were interested in terms of audience recovery. But that we're kind of looking to see if there's partners that we can include in the grant at this point. Okay, we can go ahead. So I think that's the gist of the project. So I have to admit, this was put together by Katrina Pike, who's our coordinator, and I'm presenting on her behalf. So I want to give her the kudos for putting together that project and all that creative thinking. I wanted to ask the group, I have five questions for you that we wanted to know. Our first one is, we wanted to target this exhibit for teachers and students, elementary school teachers and students with curriculum connections. And then we also wanted it to fill this need for non-traditional museum visitors. So going out to like the fair or like the farmers market or community events, things like that. And we wanted to know if you felt like this would meet those target groups, like if this plan, you felt like it worked well within that demographic. So that's my first question. Any overall, I guess, comments as well, or what do you think? Do you like it? Would you like to see something changed? Do you have any suggestions in general?
Hi, Laura. This is Aisha. Hi. I think it's an amazing idea because, you know, giving a hands-on experience, it couldn't get better. And your suggestion that it should be taken to the teachers, students, and community events, I think it increases the exposure and visibility of the museum itself. So I think it's an amazing idea.
Okay.
Yeah, this is Carol. I agree with Aisha completely. I was going to say basically the same thing she did. I think it's a great idea. And I think especially for schools, and you talked about farmers markets, and people love to do hands-on things when they're going to farmers markets.
Even for seniors, I think they'll enjoy it.
And then I wanted to know from the group, is there anything, like, what did you like most about it? Like, what about it? Like, you mentioned the hands-on element, but is there anything in it that you're like, oh my gosh, don't lose this. This looks so cool.
It's Kathy. I really like that you're thinking of the VR. Hands-on, the kitchen's cool, the VR, but the activities with the kids is great. But, you know, you've combined the old and new. It's great.
You know, Laura, there is a video game out there called Farm Simulator. I think that you would definitely hit a new demographic of an age group you might not even thought about before.
Okay.
Maybe combining the game elements into this, so it kind of so they can recognize, and the kids probably might like it more.
And then are there any suggestions? Usually we find this group has great suggestions about how to be inclusive of diversity or different stories or accessibility. Obviously we'll try to make sure that there's a ramp that you can get into the trailer with. I don't know how we'll have to try to make it as accessible as possible so all the kids can get in there and get out safely. But any kind of thoughts or suggestions there, or did you feel like it was like any thoughts around that?
Yeah, I think I come from a South Asian community, and con is loved there, but it is not usually the butter con, or it's like roasted, like on charcoal. So maybe including that could be a good idea. I don't know.
Maybe a cultural corn cookbook.
Yeah,
that's a good idea.
And then is there anything that you think doesn't appeal to you about what was presented that you're like, oh, don't put that in, or steer clear of this, or anything? Like, obviously what we presented, we might not be able to do all of that. We, Katrina found this amazing fabricator that does children's exhibits, like specifically agricultural exhibits. So they would be able to outfit the entire trailer for us based on our design. So we're hopeful if we get the grant, that would be kind of a one-stop shop, which would be great. Any final comments, thoughts about this? Otherwise, everyone thinks it's a good idea. Good, thumbs up. Okay, great. Perfect. Thank you for your feedback. I will let Katrina know, and we'll forge ahead with the grant proposal. So that's going well. I also wanted to, this isn't on the agenda, but I also wanted to follow up with the group that last time we met, you gave us feedback about integrating public art at the museum for the 175th year of the Greenwood Blacksmith Shop. So we did have submitted a proposal for that to the Legacy Fund. And so we've applied for community banners, playable sculptural art, and large murals that would be kind of a contemporary take on the history of blacksmithing in Greenwood. So we're hopeful that we get that, and we'll find out in about 6 months if we've been successful or not. So I just wanted to thank you for your input on that as well. It really made us think about things in a different way. So that was great. I think I have on the list also the deaccession list.
Yeah, if you're done with this subject, we had a double put in there. The new Moa Museum proposal and the traveling exhibit concept presentation were the same item. So we've done that. So yes,
okay.
Now on to your deconfession.
So at the museum, we got a grant to hire some staff to move our collection. So we are doing all kinds of collections moves on the site. We've moved out artifacts out of the blacksmith shop so that the blacksmith shop can undergo some rehabilitation work. We are moving artifacts out of our Gate 3 drive shed so that we can update that facility. It's kind of like a lean-to kind of structure, but we put in some electrical and things like that. And then we are also moving all of our large artifacts, which are like tractors, steam engines, cars, fire trucks, out of our upper site warehouse into sea cans so that we can put some shelving in and reinforce that structure so that it's good for the next 30 years. So with those moves, there are a number of artifacts that are up for deaccession. These artifacts are either damaged beyond repair. They don't, they're like individual items that don't, like it might be like a spoke and we don't know, like it doesn't fit into anything else. So it's like an isolated piece, or it is rusted and it's no longer the best example of what we would show for sort of our historical value. Or we might have a whole bunch of other artifacts that are in better condition, and we are at the point where we need the space. So a lot of these artifacts that are on the deaccession list, unfortunately, have been sitting out in the open. Some of them have been out there for like 30 years. So some of them are in less than favorable condition. But the great thing is now that we're working on this warehouse, all of those artifacts that originally had been stored outside or might have been stored outside in the past are all in under shelter, and they're protected against the elements. So I think the list was the list sent out to everybody? It was?
The list was okay, perfect. In the agenda.
So the process for this list is the deaccession list is developed. In this case, it was developed by Jenna, who's our hired collections assistant. It goes through our conservator, who looks at it and ensures that everything on the list should be recommended for deaccession based on our policy. Then it goes through me, and I confirm that it's should be deaccessioned according to our policy. Then it comes to the committee for your recommendation to deaccession, and then it goes to a report to council for their approval to deaccession the items. Once the items are approved to be deaccessioned, our first thing that we do is we look for other institutions that may want the artifacts. Usually when the stuff's like beyond repair, there's not a lot of takers, but sometimes they will. So we'll put a call out to all the Ontario museums to see if anybody, if it fits in their mandate and they'd like it. If not, we see if we can auction the items off. And if that's not possible, then they're disposed of in an ethical way. Any questions about the process or anything like that? So we sent out the list. Most of the stuff on the list is wagon wheels. There were some pictures attached. Quite a few spokes. Most of the stuff is wooden in nature, and so that's why it's deteriorated. Some of the stuff had pest damage, and so it's very difficult to fix that when things bore into the wood. We had a couple of old boxes and some rusted metal pieces that are no longer part of a set, or they're damaged beyond repair. So if it's possible to have, what do we do, a motion? How do we, what's the language around the voting for this? Do we ask for a recommendation from the committee, or?
I'm trying to think what we did the first year that you had came to the committee and brought this up. I believe you just presented it and there was no objection to it. But I know you have your own museum rules to follow.
So yeah, so if there's, If there's quorum, if it's possible, yes, to have a recorded vote in the minutes that the deaccession list has been considered, and if the committee is willing to put a recommendation into deaccession, I think that'd be great to show in the minutes, unless there was any questions.
One of the appointed members will have to request for a recorded vote. Okay. And then we can you know, put forward, you can, well, Jesse or one of the appointed members could put forward some sort of motion. I'm sure we can, you know, later draft it more formally when we do it in the minutes, and then we can call the vote.
So perfect. Do I have an appointed member willing to put forward?
Arianna. Hi, it's Arianna here. I'm so sorry, I don't recall actually seeing the list.
Okay. Laura, do you have it handy right now?
Yep. I can send it. Do you want me to email it to you?
Well, if it's just me, then that's fine. But I don't know if other people have received it. But is it long? Like, is it something that you could read out or put it on screen or different way you could put the information?
So the question is, Laura, is the list, can we have time to look through it quickly and have them review it, or is it exactly word for word what you had spoken of? Like, I guess it was not attached, as I had thought.
Oh, okay, I see. I can, should I email it to you, Molly, and then you can put it on the screen?
Sure, yeah.
Yeah.
We can just scroll through it quickly. That's a good idea. We have time. So if we can accomplish it today, that would be great.
I'm trying to find your email address, Molly.
It's R. Pereira.
Pereira?
Yep. Yeah, P with the P for Peter.
Wait, can you put it in the chat, because it's not coming up on my thing, and then I'll email it to you. Perfect. Oh, Pereira. Coming your way. Sorry, apologies for that. So it's just the PDF has the photos, which is probably the easiest way to look at it.
I'm remembering last time we had it, we were in person and we had printouts.
Yeah.
Okay, got it. I'm going to share it now.
Thank you, Ramon.
Okay, so what you're looking at, the first things are the descriptions. So you can see the first wagon wheel, dry rot, there's a large crack in the wheel, no metal rim. So it's the conservators made a decision that this is cannot be, we do not have the ability to conserve this, preserve or treat this artifact. The second one, dry rot, large crack in the wheel, no metal rim, same thing. Third, badly rusted, wood rotted, broken, half the wood is missing, etc. Wood rotted, missing in one spot, two spokes free and others loose, metal rusted. So we can move down. Again, wood rim is dry and rotted, splitting, separating from the metal rim. Wood is dry, cracked, and rotted, unstable. dry rot wood is cracked and loose. Wood is breaking, etc.
Should I stop sharing?
Yeah, we can move down one more. There's pictures down below, so that might help just to kind of see what it is. Another wagon wheel. Oh, sorry. There was a coal bin up there as well. Evidence of wood rot, bottom of one side's unstable. So these are things like if you picked it up, it would like fall apart. Some of them, unfortunately. And then we have a number of pallets which have metal items on them. You'll see what they look like. So there's on those pallets, there's like a wheel, plow, that kind of thing. So this one, the next pallet, most artifacts are unknown pieces of farming equipment. They're missing pieces, decayed wood with insect damage. Most artifacts are unknown or too rusted to find the numbers. The next pallet, the wooden base is broken and rotted. There's burrow holes, metal fragments, things like that. Pallet 75, a plow is in several pieces. His metal is rusted and caused damage to the hooks and other features. The iron fence, the fence is severely rusted and rough to touch due to oxygenation of iron, etc. So if we go down again, you'll see the pieces. So here's the wheels. So again, this is where the conservator, so we're lucky we have two people on the case this time who are actual conservators. We usually just have one. Who've made the determination that these are beyond an ability to be fixed or repaired or are unstable. So we have these wagon wheels. And then there's the coal bin on T464. And then these are some of the pallets. So you can see some of the pallets, like these are just fragments of metal pieces. And these were actually, some of them were pulled up out of the like grass. And those would have been from the 60s and 70s from the museum when it was brought over. So some of them are just rusted beyond repair, and there's the fence at the bottom.
That's it.
Any questions about anything like that? So I wanted to just kind of assure people that whenever a deaccession happens, people are like, ooh, getting rid of stuff. We always have an active acquisition process in place. So we do accept new items, and we're always looking for items that have a specific Pickering history, tell a Pickering story, are in really good condition, and that we have the space to store them. So those are kind of the conditions we look for when we accept new items. And I think last year, I don't know if the committee knew, but we got this donation of a Pickering hearse from the 1920s. So this is a great example of deaccessioning these kinds of items. So we have this really cool vehicular collection piece that we can now put into the warehouse. Any questions about any of that stuff?
So we just are looking for appointed members. Sorry.
Oh, hi, Arianna. Just saying, it was very thorough. And it's interesting that you explained the process before that went to other museums to see if there's interest there, and otherwise auction, because you could see some of these things would be of interest perhaps for decoration or, some art with recycled pieces, or so there could be some great things that could happen with it. Anyways, I'm happy to, what did we decide was the way to do it? I can introduce a motion to accept it, or how do we grade it?
We'll be accepting the list as is, Laura? Is that where?
So if you could, if there was a motion to accept the recommendation to deaccession the items, that would be great.
I'm happy to move that.
And if before we call the vote, if member wants to ask a recorded vote, they can. If not, we can simply do just a regular vote.
However it works best for you. Do you need a recorded vote?
I think Laura had mentioned that she wanted one, so that's why I put that. Or if not, we can just call the vote. And if Aisha and Ariana just want to say yay, then that is carried.
This is Aisha. Yay.
Are we good with Romali?
Yeah, we're good.
All right. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
We're going to get smoother on these things.
Sorry.
No, it's all right. I should have been more prepared for sure. But thank you, Laura. Go ahead. And then the next museum, item is right, what's that?
Was that it? That was it from the museum, right?
Yeah, that was it for the museum. Great. And now we move on to item number 6, which is also Laura, which is her real reason for being here today, which was an update on the city center consultation and project proposal.
Project proposal. So I wanted to give everybody an update on the city center consultation. We did have over the summer in July and August a community consultation for the buildings that make up the city center project, which include the youth and senior center, the performing arts center, and the new central library. So we took it out to the community with some renderings and got some great consultation. And I just wanted to let the group know that at this point, staff are pulling together all of the information from the consultation. There will also be a financial report that will be going to council potentially October 7th. If not, it will be called later in October. The meeting hasn't been called yet to make a decision about the city center project and whether it will be whether it will proceed, whether it be paused or whether it will not proceed, kind of thing. So I just wanted to let the group know that that happened over the summer. And if there were any kind of questions around that initiative at this point, I think some of you would have been involved through other means, and this group was certainly invited to those consultations as well. Nope, okay, great. Thanks.
Don't see any questions. So again, committee members, if you do have any questions after the fact, please email me and I can pass them on to Laura for answering. You have anything else, Laura? Is that it for today?
Excellent. I think that's it for me.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. So item number 7 is other business. Does any of the members present today have any other business to bring up to the committee?
Hi, it's Kathy. Can I mention one thing?
Yes, please go ahead, Kathy.
Okay. I just wanted to mention at the library, the National Day for Truth and Reconciliation is taking place on Thursday, September the 30th, and it's a brand new federal statutory holiday. And technically, the Pickering Public Library would be closed, but we didn't think it was appropriate to close when it's a day that we're all supposed to be doing our learning. So the Pickering Central Library will be open. It'll be staffed by staff who volunteered to work that day. And to celebrate, we've created a video with 3 Indigenous authors, David A. Robertson, Melanie Florence, and Jay Ojik, who is an Algonquin artist who also illustrates for Robert Munch. I've been able to see the footage, and it's incredibly inspiring. They don't really talk about, they don't read their books, but what they're trying to do is talk to you about what books to use to talk to children about the residential school system. So I hope you'll be able to join us on video online and in person. And we have shared the video with Durham Region Libraries and York Region Libraries, who will also be playing it that day. So I just wanted to mention that.
Thank you very much, Kathy. Does anybody have a question for Kathy about that initiative? Well, okay. So that's the end of the agenda for the evening. So unless anybody has anything else to bring up for this evening, I have a motion to adjourn from a member.
Yeah, I motion to adjourn.
Okay. Well, thank you much, everybody, for showing up this evening, and we'll see you in October.
Thanks, Jesse.
Thanks, everyone.